Let's say we had a time machine. You and all of your buddies really want to go back in time and experience something from your childhood that you thought was so cool. For some, it was to go back and experience Halo 3 coming out. For some, it was watching DBZ for the first time. And for some, it was to eat stupid Dunkaroos, you sickos. But for me, let's take the time machine back to 2007. It's a nice summer morning as I'm kicking back, watching Foster's Home for Imaginary Friends. The old Cartoon Network president had just stepped down because of an Adult Swim promotion, being confused for a terrorist attack. This is not a joke. And very soon, Ben 10's last season is about to start. But my attention was directed towards the screen when a new trailer dropped for a game that was to come out soon. What is that? Ben 10 almost got killed in the streets, and now that bus has veins. This is FusionFall, Cartoon Network's response to the MMORPG craze that everyone was obsessed with during the 2000s. No one could shut up about WoW or EverQuest for the longest time, I swear. The game was a giant crossover event that promised a huge expansive world of familiar environments and recognizable characters from the Cartoon Network lineup. From 2009 to 2013, FusionFall was one of my favorite games, as it was my first MMO experience, and my first online experience playing with friends on the internet. But what made it so special? Well, that's what I set out to do in this video, where we take a look back at the 2009 CN MMORPG IRL TLDR LOL LMAO XD FusionFall.
We're making an MMO, and we're doing it Cartoon Network style. For the first time ever, team up with your favorite Cartoon Network characters.
As a child with a single mother, I grew up on cable. I watched plenty of stuff like PBS Kids with Arthur, Disney Channel with Kim Possible, and Danny Phantom on Nick, but gosh darn it, I was a Cartoon Network kid at heart. Kids Next Door, Samurai Jack, Kids Next Door, Foster's, Kids Next Door. Did I mention I've enjoyed Kids Next Door? When FusionFall was announced to the world, the biggest selling point was that it was to cross over the whole entire Cartoon Network universe. Ed would speak to Mandark, Mojo Jojo would fight with Eduardo, and Hostogato, well, he's there. I remember I spent a couple of days writing down where each character was and would check it off when I had talked to them or not, because I really loved all the characters. They were just people I were really close to. Each of them had this new anime-inspired style, which some looked great and they translated nicely, and then there was Jake the Dog. With each big Cartoon Network character, an evil alter ego called a fusion existed not too far away. A fusion is this green, gooey version of all your favorite characters that give you things called nanos, which are small versions of your favorite characters that you can abuse like a Pokemon and attack the bus dinosaurs. The whole point of this cast was to get missions from these characters in order to progress. That's how an MMO works. Some would have you going across the entire continent, some would have you two teaming up to fight a fusion or to retrieve a nano. In the original build of the game, you would do missions to gain XP, get items, then when you level up, you'd get to grab one nano. It was really neat to grab little versions of your favorite characters and create your team to give yourself some extra damage, give yourself healing, or even gain some extra speed or mobility. You know, I wish that we would have gotten nanos of some lesser known shows like Mucha Lucha or Class of 3000, but the biggest missed out opportunity was getting Andrew WK to have a nano from Destroy Build Destroy.
Here's a question I get asked over and over and over again. Dear Andrew WK, what does the WK stand for? Well, let's see what you think.
We'll kill you. We'll kill you.
Over time, there were bigger and better updates to the game, adding more characters, nanos, and even changing how the story went. When the game first began, you started out in the future after Fuse had attacked, and you spent the first four levels getting to the past. This would get you four nanos and a good grasp of the game. You started out in this part of the map and only got about this much. I just like to take the moment in the future section. You see what's left over after the attack. You see what has been left over after the fight with Fuse. So you spawn in Sector V and see these statues, right? Okay. This memorial right here is supposed to memorialize those who fought valiantly against Fuse. It shows Ben 10, Dexter, Mojo Jojo, Double D, and Blue. It is legitimately considered that most of the Cartoon Network characters are freaking dead. It is actual lore that Blue sacrificed himself for a great cause to be memorialized. Legit, so many people are dead. Out of the 96 characters in the whole past section, the future section only has 9. 9 whole characters. The rest are considered dead, missing in action, or in hiding. What the heck? In 2011, the beginning of the story changed to
The Academy.
Where you were trained in the future to head back to the past. This changed up the way that you received nanos, so instead of getting one nano every level, you could get multiple nanos every 4 levels. So by the time you went back to the past, you were loaded. This gave room for many characters to be added on, either by giving out free codes or just different missions spread throughout the levels. Now, there was a difficulty cap for some of the nanos, however, as if, for example, I got to level 12, I had the option to go grab the group of nanos that were across the map and that I had access to, but some were definitely still meant to be played later on around levels 14 or 15, kind of spreading them out so that way you don't get them all at once, because getting nanos is one of the best parts. This gave the game a little bit more challenge and helped you try and prioritize where you needed to go next. Now, personally, I really liked
The Academy
because there was more to the world. You were being trained in the Null Void, you were being led by Ben 10, you had so many nanos, and you went back to the past on Lady Rainicorn's back. A lot of fans complained, but I personally thought the change wasn't that bad. Another cool add-on for characters was getting random free nanos via codes, which was always cool just to log in one day and get Mordecai as part of your group. The game kept adding on more nanos by code or by missions for quite some time, and after a while, it even got Johnny Test. I hate this game.
Dex, come in!
This is Dexter. Go ahead.
It's Ben. I'm downtown. It's worse than we thought.
So how is it that all of these characters are able to just be around each other while Fuse is busy giving the planet the business? Well, it's because all of Cartoon Network exists on the same planet. So always remember, while Johnny Bravo is aggressively flirting with women, Chowder is trying to become the next Gordon Ramsay. Depending on which year that you hopped into the game, you'd start in the Future Suburbs area, a wrecked and destroyed portion of the map that's on its own after the war with Fuse. You walk around and see the remnants of houses, green water, and the K&D military ready for anything. It's a little depressing when you think about how everyone has died. The thing about when the game first came out is that it was on a subscription system. So everyone could play this dark and depressing game for the first 4 levels, but in order to see your favorite characters actually live, you had to cough up the cash. Now I can finally see number one in all of his bald glory. There's a lot more cargo shorts than I remember. But then you get back to the past, and it's fine. You again are in the suburbs and get to walk around and see it's actually not trashed to bits. In this version, you can visit places like the Candy Treehouse, Dexter's House, Ensville, Megas XLR himself, the Powerpuff home, and the grand masterpiece, Foster's. This is the bare bones, basic places, starting section of the game. It's peaceful with suburban neighborhoods and nice parks. Well, it's peaceful as it can be with monsters running around. Then depending on whether you go north or south, you can enter downtown or the wilds. Downtown is an area of large skyscrapers, huge monorails, and large meeting areas. This is places from the Powerpuff Girls, Johnny Bravo, and Juniper Lee. Downtown is just the techno city paradise that you can totally see having Dexter's handiwork, and then there's this volcano in the middle of town. I love the concept art for downtown because it was so ambitious and had so many cool designs for it. It makes the end product look lame in comparison, if I'm being honest. After some updates, even got Ice King's castle off in the middle of the ocean. It was trying to hide the secret island behind it that was the shape of a skull. And I swear to you, this was put out there with the intention to get there later. The ocean, I felt, had so much potential because you could get out so far, and there was a secret island with a secret boss you could fight, but you couldn't make it out to that dang island over there. Maybe it was just a tease, but it looked like it held so much more. Maybe even more secrets to the game, or maybe it was more menacing than we thought. The last area of the main past world is the wilds, the northern area of the map, and my personal favorite area. It's the woods, the forests, the greenery, the cliffs, the caves, all nice and expansive. You can visit places from Courage the Cowardly Dog and Camp Lazlo, but newer places like the ruins that give the place some memorable new locations. I loved exploring through the big hills, giant waterfalls, and weird locations in this area. I definitely spent most of my time just finding new discoveries throughout this whole area and finding interesting little rarities. Mount Blackhead used to be a grand place to trade, and I loved seeing how many people would be there trading just wild stuff. I remember this one time, I had this guitar gun, and this dude legit hacked in 7 million taros, the currency of the game, and gave them to me for this one gun. The trades used to be so whack. Now, that was just the main map, but the final area was the most devastating and dangerous place in the whole game. The Darklands. Now, you can't get there by walking, because that's just not efficient. It's across the water. You can get over there like a little baby and spend some money on the scamper, or you can ride a serpent over to the battlefield. You get there to a flying battleship with Samurai Jack and Tetrax, and the only remaining people in the Darklands that are camped out are Demongo, an actual demon, and Cheese. You walk through the fire-laced lands all the way to Fuse's lair, then fight him once and beat the whole game. Yeehaw, that's cool. These areas to me were iconic, avoiding enemies in certain areas just to talk to cool characters, and then Fuse's lair is one of the coolest moments in the whole game because it literally applies to nothing and it doesn't matter because everything is still around after you beat him. Cool. Exploring around and going to these places for the first time are fond memories, and I still really like these areas. If it was around, I'd love to play it, but sadly, the servers were shut down in 2013. But wait, it got remade.
None of us were prepared when Planet Fuse arrived, ready to consume our world.
So FusionFall's lifespan consisted of 3.5 years of mixed reception, cool add-ons, a cool opening manga, one developer shutting down, two opening campaigns, a whole rework, and a lot of dedicated fans. But even that couldn't keep FusionFall alive. Gragon Entertainment, the original developers of the game, shut down not too long after FusionFall had launched. So what did the goobers at Cartoon Network try to do? Run it themselves, and it looked like this. Yeah, Cartoon Network had no clue what they were doing, so they basically couldn't keep it up. So in 2013, all the servers had closed down. All my progress swept away by the internet overlords. I was so in love with this game. I logged easily over 400 hours into it. I had my own notebooks filled with notes about it. I even had the victory pack you could pick up at GameStop for like $20. Years went by and plenty of people mourned the loss of the game. And even though it was a kid's game, it still had a really solid following from a ton of fans. It seems to be the trend with web-based kid MMOs.
So, yeah. Pretty stupid.
I was always sent plenty of attempts to revive the game, but none really caught any traction. That is, until a small dev team began work on FusionFall Retro and FusionFall Legacy. Retro was the original game created in all of its glory, the OG 36 nanos and levels, no add-ons, no
Academy.
All of its original apocalyptic glory. Retro went fully live in September in 2018, having the whole world to explore again. I can finally go back and see my bald child again.
And there was much rejoicing.
Legacy was an entirely new experience created by the self-proclaimed Universe team, which was supposed to be a major rework for the game with new content, but the original build that you know and love. It looked stellar. Everything was looking up for the Universe team. The fans were happy, and the world was rejoicing.
Hey! Hey! He ain't playing no games! What is that?
Oh, Neptune.
The Universe team was sadly shut down by Turner themselves, and to be honest, I'm surprised it lasted this long. Although the game lasted for quite some time, nothing good can last forever, and the DMCA gave our good old boys and girls a nice smack on the buns. Thousands of people, including me, were greatly disappointed. I mean, all that hard work and now it's all gone because Fred Flintstone just wanted to exercise his rights and protect his property. But it's justified, seriously. It sucks, but that's kind of the risk of recreating older games outside of the original owners. Now, Retro and Legacy are definitely not the only fan-made projects dedicated to bringing back the game, as most of the gameplay for this video was run on the servers for the Open Fusion project. You can play both Academy and Classic campaigns of the game either on public or private servers. This video wouldn't have been possible without my classic character, ShrugPod, or my alter ego in the Academy campaign, Avenger Banjo. It's a true blessing to play these games again, and hopefully these will stick around for a while until I can at least break level 25. FusionFall to me was my first big online gaming experience, and a great one at that. My mom's old Dell laptop could have flown to the moon with how quick the fans were going. Me and my friend would be on the phone with each other, just talking for hours trying to get through certain dungeons and infected zones, and I loved scaring my grandmother, because she thought that I was going to get kidnapped by somebody online. Of course, this game isn't perfect. Far from it, actually. But that's how I like it. Flawed, but enjoyable. I'll remember every memory I had that helped me get into online games and enjoy new experiences that would make me waste hundreds of hours and be super unproductive. But seriously, what the heck is up with Jake?